You can delete
that.
It's my belly button.
Da-da-da-da!
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, weirdos and geeks, not to mention the nerds, welcome to part 2 of Phantom Studios Civil War Review.
Part 2!
Yep.
Abraham Lincoln dies at this part.
Shut up, you!
We're on Civil War there, buddy. This is the Marvel one, not the real life one.
He dies in the after credit scene.
And I have to say, this movie was marvelous.
That was perfect. And Jeremy smacked you in the face.
He deserved it.
Thank you, Captain Obvious. All right.
I did.
The last part one of the review, we made it to the airport battle, where the epic, quite frankly, epic Avengers clash happened.
What are the not epic Avengers?
All of the Avengers were epic in that fight.
Okay.
But
okay.
Yeah, that airport's done. That airport's destroyed.
I think everything made it a little bit better is if Hulk took on the Thor for a rematch.
Oh, that would have been interesting. They're off on another planet for Ragnarok.
Oh yeah, Thor's off on that, and then Hulk's just trying to learn to gain control of himself.
Somehow he ends up on another planet. I'm not sure how they're going to explain that.
He was picked up in an alien teleportation beam and zapped across the universe.
No, I found a magical hot dog and it took me there.
I think that was a trap by Loki. Actually, that was
Loki made a magical hot dog that teleports you to another planet.
I don't think that was a hot dog.
Well, it was long and shaped like one, but it had a bunch of spikes on it. I think it was a hot dog covered in barbed wire.
Okay, that's enough. That's enough.
Done.
We haven't even started the review.
I knew you were coming back.
Sorry. Alright, you got that one? Cool.
Right.
Oh,
my hand.
Hey, Brent.
What up? Hi, Deshaun. You can delete that out, right?
Bloopers!
Yeah. Okay, so, back to Civil War. After the airport battle, there's actually quite a few interesting scenes that happen before the big finale. So, I don't remember which is the exact order they come in, but one scene is Bucky and Cap talk.
Oh, when they land at the base.
No. Not when they land at the base, while they're flying.
Yeah.
And the scene where Bucky says, "I'm not sure I'm worth all this to you." Do you remember that one? Yeah.
I think so.
Maybe.
Yeah, I think I remember.
Yeah. I really liked that scene because it shows that, like, it confirms that Bucky is having a little bit of a self-worth crisis. I really did like this scene. I do wish they had added one little thing, like, gone a little more in-depth on, like how Bucky feels and all that. But, like, one thing I really wanted to see was Cap, like, look at Bucky, or maybe, like, put it on autopilot, stand up in front of him and say, "Look, dude, I don't care what you've done, you're my friend. I'm with you to the end of the line." Like, I think that would have been...
Like that line from the Winter Soldier.
Yeah. Yeah, but as the scene, as it happens, ends, like, it's done very well the way it happens, I think.
Yeah.
Yeah. And, like, it was, that was the one moment where I was like, where I really felt like
they kind of sold it short of the scene, I guess.
I mean, what they did was great. It's just there could have been one other thing to make it better. That was, but I still give it like two.
With the massive schedule they got, I bet Disney don't have time.
Basically, yeah. So in the next scene, I don't remember the exact order, but then Iron Man goes over to the prison in the middle of the ocean where they've stashed the Avengers. Ross is ticked at him.
As usual, Ross is the kind of general that actually was hunting the Hulk for a little while. So why the heck would you put him in charge of this? He's a madman who ticked off one of the most powerful beings on Earth, so he's strong enough to lift up a continent.
Yeah.
And you decide to tick him off by hunting him to make him a weapon? Ross, you're an idiot.
Yeah, basically. Oh wait, one thing we completely glossed over
what
was...
What did he lift?
Hulk is actually strong enough at his full strength to lift up a continent.
Yeah. Okay. But yeah, one thing we kind of glossed over.
I guess I missed the memo.
Yeah. Was Baron Zemo.
Oh.
Yeah, we kind of glossed over him in the last one. So like his overall plan is to frame Bucky for blowing up the national or the United Nations thing in Vienna. So
in
like
Austria,
he's got,
it's actually Vienna is actually the capital of Austria.
Yeah. But one thing that happens like after the airport scene is the hotel that he was staying at, the maid. She comes in and she sees like this dead body in the bathtub, and there's this face mask thing designed to impersonate Bucky. And at some point before Iron Man goes to the prison, he learns about this.
I think it was when he left the prison.
No. It was when he got to the prison, because he got to the prison and was telling Ross about it, and Ross said that after the fiasco in Leipzig, the name of the airport, I think?
Leipzig,
the fiasco in Leipzig, do you really think I'd listen to you? You're lucky you're not in one of those cells.
You guys alright?
Yeah.
You guys just want to stay, if you want to, you can stay and talk.
Yeah, we'll be good.
Okay.
We'll be good, we won't destroy anything.
Okay. Hopefully.
You're not filling us with confidence, Jeremy.
This is the room with the mark on the wall from when we did that lightsaber thing. Well,
okay.
This marked it as.
So many memories.
I do apologize for any interruptions in case I don't edit them out. We are at youth group. We're probably supposed to be doing something else, but we decided, you know what? We love our viewers. We're going to finish the review. Even though the fan on my computer is bad and my computer has a death wish and I can't upload anything at the moment. But by the time this video is actually uploaded, all of those technical problems will be resolved.
Hopefully.
So,
and hopefully
your computer
won't explode.
I could swear it was going to explode when I uploaded the Gathering video, but yeah. This might be uploaded 2 weeks from now. We are recording this on June 1st.
Like everything else that's uploaded on Phantom Studios.
Yeah, basically. So anyway. Back to the review. Iron Man finds out about that. Ross is ticked at him. Iron Man goes to talk to the other Avengers. They're not happy with him.
Of course, Barton.
Yeah.
And of course, Scarlet Witch. And then, of course, you got Ant-Man. And, of course, Ant-Man says something that I love. I guess Hank Pym was right. You can't trust a Stark. Especially with the relationship between Hank and Howard Stark.
Wait, what?
Hank Pym was involved in the early days of S.H.I.E.L.D.
Who's Hank?
Hank Pym was the original Ant-Man in the Ant-Man movie.
He never saw the Ant-Man movie, but there was an original Ant-Man.
Wait, is he the... I've seen a clip on YouTube where Ant-Man fights Falcon. He's the old guy that's kind of listening in on...
Yes, he's the old guy.
Yeah.
That's Hank Pym.
The guy that when Ant-Man says, I thought you said this was an abandoned warehouse. It's not! He's like, pull out. Like that guy?
Yes, that's
okay.
The old guy.
Okay.
That's Hank Pym. He was the original Ant-Man back during the Cold War.
Okay.
And he had a bit of a beef with Howard Stark because Stark and a couple of other guys from the DOD tried to replicate the Pym particle for creating the Ant-Man behind his back, and he pretty much got ticked at him and punched the DOD guy in the face.
Dang.
Yeah.
And I guess he was watching it.
What?
Carter, Agent Carter, the original, that new Cap.
Oh,
she was involved with that on that conversation.
Oh man,
you gotta see the Ant-Man movie. It ties into that story with that line.
I learned this from YouTube.
You know
the end credit scene is actually like the bit where they have like after the whole helicopters thing where Bucky, Falcon, and Cap are talking.
Yeah.
And Bucky's got his arm stuck in the thing. Like that's actually the end credit scene. For Ant-Man, I didn't find that on YouTube, but anyway. So going back to the movie, Tony specifically talks to Falcon. Falcon fills them in on what Cap and Bucky are doing, where they are, what they're up against.
You want to know something? In the Ant-Man movie, Ant-Man takes down Falcon, and now he's working with him.
That's hilarious.
That was funny. I love the bit where he's like, where Ant-Man's kind of like, hey, so dude, about what happened before, it was a nice audition. And then, I want to know if, like, what Cap said to them, if Cap ever said anything to those two about that, because Falcon specifically said to his comlink, it is very important to me that Cap never finds out about this. So I bet Cap, during that scene, was going like, what? Like, what did I miss? That's even funnier now.
I don't think Cap was there. I think that's why Polkin said it.
That would have been funny though, like after the battle, like after the movie ends, Cap is just like, so, Sam, what was that thing you said to the ant guy about it's not gonna happen again? And then Sam's just
don't
like,
you
oh.
go talk. Don't say a word.
It's like, yeah.
Not a word.
And, yeah, Ant-Man's about to start talking and Sam just gives him a look that clearly just says,
to me, that scene where Falcon says that in the movie is just as funny as that scene and the scene where Cap kisses that girl and then Falcon and Bucky are like,
that was
perfect.
I didn't like that kiss, but that moment was perfect.
Yeah, that moment is just perfect because they look back at the blood truck and they're like, and Cap's just like,
move your chair forward.
I thought it was a water truck.
Yeah, that still was funny. He's like, here, Cap, throw this at. And Cap throws it, and Cap throws that, and then he's like, oh, come on! Oh, man, I thought it was a water truck!
Okay, we're getting off topic.
Okay, off topic,
okay.
Back on topic.
Okay, so Falcon basically asks Tony to help him, and specifically makes him promise to go alone as Iron Man, not United Nations, not bring anybody, just him alone. So Iron Man agrees, they take the helicopter, says he's gonna put Ross on hold. I thought that was funny. He's like, oh, well, what happens if I need you? I'll put you on hold. Wait, put. Hire a helicopter, takes off.
Yeah.
He also
started getting information about what Cap and Bucky were looking into, about this guy, and that he was in Sokovia, he was part of a special commando squadron, and that his family, and, well, not that his family died in Sokovia, but that he had in the hotel room that he was staying in was the dead body of the psychiatrist that was supposed to show up.
Oh yeah, that was the body, right.
And of course, a silicone mask and disguise kit with a wig,
right.
That was the perfect disguise for Sergeant James Barnes.
Yep.
And then, of course, he takes his arm out of his cast, puts it on the thing, and gets in the suit.
That was kind of like, wait, he can turn the chair into a thing, into like an escape?
It's Tony Stark, dude! It's Tony Stark!
And the best bit of that scene was, as he's flying off to Siberia, we see behind him the Black Panther in a plane.
Oh, you don't screw around with Wakanda. Wakanda is the leader of the
Wakanda.
World. America may be the last remaining superpower, but Wakanda is the one that's going to take its place when it falls.
Yep.
In America,
because of Obama, it's gonna fall pretty quick.
Obamacare is gonna be the death of us.
It's gonna come much faster if either Bernie Sanders or Hillary Clinton gets elected. That's just our political opinion. Anyone out there who actually likes those guys, please.
Respectful comments, otherwise your comments get deleted.
Yes, please. We this is just our opinion.
Yes.
You have an opinion, we respect that. We're just stating ours.
Yeah.
Thank the Lord Obama is not the president.
I recorded a video on my phone and at the end of it my friend Steven said Trump for president. I'm like,
Hail Hydra?
Trump is actually decent, and in fact unfortunately the guy I have to vote for him. Because the guy that I wanted to vote for, Ted Cruz, he dropped out of the running.
You voted for Ted Cruz.
Trump
and
is
then
basically
lesser of two.
This election is the Kobayashi Maru. Trump is just the best case
this election?
We were talking about how Wakanda is going to take over the world after the U.S. falls.
Yeah, like if the U.S. drops out.
Let's get back to the movie, please.
And it just farted. I'm sorry.
You, smack him, please.
Nine! That wasn't good.
Okay.
That hurt.
Okay, so.
Okay, stop it! Yeah.
That was overkill, but I don't care. I loved it.
Okay,
so. Back now. Cap and Bucky land the plane, and there's the scene that you are so fond of mentioning.
They start talking about the old times when they grew up in Brooklyn and the fact that they dated.
That lady's probably more than 100 years old.
Dude, we're more than 100 years old.
Yeah. No, it was dude, so are we.
Dude, we're both over 100 years old.
I liked that scene because that's another thing where like it just shows they click.
Yeah, it's just
that reminds me.
They're like Lego sets.
Captain America, the first Avenger, in the first Captain America movie, that reminds me, that scene reminds me of when these two were, like, you know, when they were
in the alleyway.
No, when they were up in the, on the mountainside, about to go after Zemo.
Zola.
Our name Zola.
Yeah.
How did you not remember that?
I keep getting Zemo and Zola mixed up. Sorry.
Sorry.
Who's Zemo?
Zemo is the guy from Civil War that's pitting the Avengers against each other. Zola is the Nazi scientist.
He's not Nazi or
Hydra.
He's Hydra and he is Swiss.
I do not eat meat.
Well, that's too
bad.
I would have loved to get my hands on that kind of meal in World War II. That was a rare meal to get in World War II.
Yeah.
Even in the West.
But yeah, that was a nice little moment because it showed, like, again, like, they click. They pick up literally right where they left off in their friendship. And it's like, okay, great. These guys are buds. They're bros.
Yeah, they're bros, man.
I'm sorry. I'll probably have a whole rant about this later. To anyone who wants Captain America to have a boyfriend, no, he is straight. No, Bucky cannot be his boyfriend.
You know, whenever something gets popular, they're like, he needs a boyfriend.
Force lightning my face off.
What?
If that happens in Infinity War, please just force lightning my face off.
That's not gonna happen! He kissed a girl in the earlier scenes of the movie!
Yeah, that's why I'm saying, like,
don't make the scene, aren't you?
Just keep talking.
Okay. Yeah, that's.
Yeah,
that?
But of course, when something like that gets pop,
oh yeah,
when someone gets popular, they're like, he needs a boyfriend.
Yeah, to me, that's kind of just.
Those are just those weirdos.
To me, that's just complete and utter stupidity because you don't take a character that has been established as something, and then say, oh well, out of the blue, there's something else. Like,
isn't
no,
that
I'm sorry,
what we're
you don't
doing
do
with our fan fiction?
Fan fictions, you can do that with.
Because
they're not canon. What they're saying is give Cap a boyfriend in the actual canon, basically.
Okay.
That you cannot do. Why? He is straight. I am sorry. That's how he is. You
I actually have a small collection of Captain America comic books where he has a girlfriend!
Exactly.
Even an older one that where he has a female super soldier girlfriend! Literally, she was upgraded with his DNA to become a super soldier.
I'll show you. Okay,
yeah. Okay,
that's in a later, but yeah.
I didn't bring it with me, but I'll show you next time.
Yeah.
Okay.
Moving on. I might be coming over to your house sooner than you think. I'll explain after the review.
Woo!
Okay. So they go into the Nazi or the Hydra base. They're looking for the Winter
Soldier.
You're
about to say Nazi.
Well, technically it was communist.
Well, they were gonna find Hitler.
Yeah. We finally figured out where Hitler's body was.
No, they burned it, actually. After Hitler committed suicide, they dragged his body out of the bunker and then they poured gasoline on it and lit it on fire. Same with his lover.
Never mind. Okay, so then they're sneaking through the base, they're looking around, they find Iron Man. Iron Man opens the door, he comes out, they strike a truce. I thought that was pretty funny how, like, he and Cap are talking and then they're making up and he's constantly looking at Bucky like, dude, seriously, you can put the gun down. We're trying to make a truce here, you're killing me.
Yeah, and he's like, okay.
And Bucky's just like,
I don't trust you.
I can't trust this guy.
Bucky's just like, no, I've got pretty bad.
And then, he should have kept that gun up, because what happens later...
Oh, yes. The big reveal. They find the Winter Soldiers have been shot. This is actually one thing that I like when a movie does this, is it's like they make you think something is going to happen, and then they blindside you.
It's called a plot twist.
Yeah, exactly. I love those. I love this one because it's like,
unless
we're on the edge of our seats. It's like, oh my gosh, there's 5 Winter Soldiers this guy's going to unleash. Oh, wait, no.
They
he
died.
Wanted, oh, wait, he shot them. Okay, cool.
No,
so he shoots
like,
the Winter Soldiers in their sleep.
You know what's funny? He says they died in their sleep. I'm like, we can see bullet holes, you idiot.
Well, technically, they were asleep when he killed them. They were in their cryostasis.
Well,
yeah,
but the way it made it sound like was they died a long time ago.
Like, they were already dead. I think they actually were already dead, because they were asleep with their eyes open.
Now, Caleb,
well,
Cap was asleep for 70 years.
Yeah, you can sleep, like, that's the thing about cryostasis, is it basically freezes you. So, I mean, unless, like, something malfunctioned in the cryo thing.
But then again, it's a Russian thing, and Russian Cold War bunkers out in Siberia, those usually last quite a while, because no one ever disturbs those.
Okay, yeah, so then dying all
so
the time.
So no one dares to touch it with their little finger.
So, okay, so... We get to the big reveal, where Zemo pulls up. I don't. Okay, I do have one or two problems with this.
Mm-hmm.
He pulls up the footage of the car accident that we saw at the very beginning of the movie, and it's revealed that Bucky is the one that killed the Starks. Or it's like, he literally caused a car to crash and then killed them. Like, he punched the dad, strangled the mom, and then he shot the security camera. So, firstly, what is a security camera doing there? And secondly,
it's
how
in the middle of the woods.
Yeah, exactly. Secondly, how did Zemo get the footage?
I think it was there.
No.
You have to remember, that was the main base where Bucky was held during the Cold War.
No. The accident, the footage of the accident.
Wait, if it's
there
the
was
winter,
a security camera.
If it's the winter soldier,
watching the whole thing.
Dude,
yeah, exactly.
If it's the winter, it looked like the area where the car crashed was much more lit up, so it might have been a lamp post that it was, that the camera was sitting on, and also.
But why would they have a camera there?
Well, I don't know.
Oh,
I don't know. I know it's a dark road, but traffic, okay?
Yeah.
And also, think about it. If they want to make sure the Russians wanted to make sure the Winter Soldier did his job properly, so they probably hacked to the security camera and downloaded the footage and watched him, and then he shot the camera.
And you have to figure if you have to figure that if it wasn't just the Russians that the communist Russians, it was Hydra. Hydra had the high tech stuff from Germany from World War II. They could easily hack into the security cameras in order to actually download the footage. So it kind of, if you have to consider the lore that feeds into this.
I didn't really think of that, but yeah, thanks guys. So it's revealed that Bucky is responsible for the Starks' deaths. Stark is really mad at this point. He asks Cap if he knew. And this is actually one thing that I think the movie did get wrong, was Cap's basically like, yeah, I knew.
I'm so fancy.
And I'm like, no, you didn't. Winter Soldier revealed, like the thing where Zola's talking to him, he reveals that Hydra is responsible for the Starks' death. That does not automatically equal Bucky. There were 5 other Winter Soldiers. Hydra has how many operatives? Any one of them could have been responsible for the Starks' deaths. Now, yes, because it's Winter Soldier, it could be assumed that Bucky, like it's a logical jump that Bucky would have killed him, but Cap does not know for a fact that Bucky killed them until he saw that security camera.
If he had the baseline information from Zola already there, then it would have made sense for him to connect the dots with that footage, and that footage to be the final piece of the puzzle of Bucky being the one to kill Howard and Maria Stark.
Well, the way the dialogue played out, it seemed like Cap already knew, and that's my thing is Cap, there's no way Cap could have known before he saw that.
Fair enough, I mean, it could have been just an average marksman that could have shot at Howard Stark and then Maria died in the crash, but no, the way they have it worked out in Civil War is Bucky deliberately crashes the car, gets Howard out of the car, punches his face in, sets him up to make it look like he died in the car crash by hitting the steering wheel and crashing in his face hard enough, and then strangles the heck out of Maria.
Yep. So, Stark freaks the heck out. He starts relentlessly trying to kill Bucky, and we get da-da-da-da-da, the big finale.
The fight between Stark and Cap.
The fight that we have probably all been waiting for. How long now?
Since Age of Ultron, actually.
Yeah.
Actually, yeah, because there was actually a line in Age of Ultron that feeds into this.
Yeah.
When they first get back from their mission in Sokovia, when they begin talking about this, when Maria Hill comes in and she's like, "All right, ready for your report, boss?" And he's like, "Oh no, I'm not the boss. He is. I just pay for everything, make everyone look cool."
Oh, yeah.
You could definitely tell by that dialogue that there was some kind of tension between Cap and Stark, between Rogers and Stark, because Stark technically paid for everything. You're making everyone look cool.
Well, I kind of thought
Heck is he still not in charge?
Because Cap is the leader.
Cap is the super soldier. He's the better strategist.
Put Stark in charge for 5 seconds and see what happens.
Okay. They would last, but not as well. But yeah, I didn't actually connect that line. I connected the whole Civil War.
Dude, if Stark was in charge, there'd be thousands
Boyd.
Of AIs everywhere.
Yeah, basically. But like, I connected it like the Civil War dots more when
they're chopping wood.
They're chopping wood, and like they're talking about like Stark stopping fights before they start. And Cap said like basically just rips the log in half and says every time someone tries to stop a war before it starts, innocent people die. That was when I was
every
like,
time.
Okay, they're disagreeing. They're getting different philosophical points, and they can't agree. This is gonna go that route. And then the other thing was when they tried to create Vision, and they're actually like literally fighting. Cap is trying to stop them from creating Vision, Iron Man is trying to create Vision. That was when I was like,
we're going
the route of these guys are going to fight each other. They're going to butt heads.
Yeah, I think that kind of got started with that line that I mentioned at the beginning of Age of Ultron, but that it really started to show
actually,
us up more and more.
Actually,
with
no.
Even
in the first Avengers movie, when they really start to meet, it's like, remember the scene in the lab?
Good point, actually, yeah.
Oh, yeah. Like this.
Suit,
like
trophy rounds.
Yeah, and then, or remember this? Or what? Like you? You're a laboratory experiment, Rogers. Everything special about you came out of a bottle.
Put on the suit.
Yeah, like they were.
Yeah.
There was definitely tension. Yeah, there was definitely some tension.
It
I think that was brought on by Loki's scepter, but I do think
of
yeah,
course
that
Loki
is, that
was using the scepter to mentally mess with their heads.
Yeah, but that is still a valid point. But
it
yeah.
did set in motion the events that then you get to see a lot more of in Age of Ultron, and then it really comes to 10 in
yep.
Captain America: Civil War.
Yeah. Okay, real quick before we go back to talking about the fight, one thing that I did not, that I also think the movie got wrong, this is just, again, these are little minor quips, they don't affect my enjoyment of the film. When they're looking at Rhodes in the hospital, Iron Man's like in shock, he's like, what happened? And Vision says, I got distracted. And Iron Man says, I didn't think that was possible. No, you dim-witted cyborg, you did not get distracted. What are you talking about? I'm like, I'm sorry, no. Vision was... He might have been distracted by Wanda, but when he shot the beam, he was aiming at Falcon, and Falcon dodged. That's not Vision's fault.
That was Falcon.
Yeah. I mean, I can't blame him for dodging the energy beam, but Vision is not the one at fault here. He was locked on target on Falcon,
and Falcon just happened to dodge it.
You know, someone...
So
you know,
don't blame...
In the original comics,
yeah.
Someone in the Civil War was supposed to die.
And
the comics,
Captain America that actually
in the comics, it was Captain America, but no one wanted him to die. So everyone was thinking it was going to be some random person. And what the way the commercials made it look like, it was a War Machine.
Yeah.
But he's still alive, and so I'm guessing...
He's just incapacitated from the waist down.
I kind of do wish that he had died, not because I dislike the character, but because I think that would have had a lot more of an impact. Because him being paralyzed does have an impact on like the characters in him. It does have an emotional impact, but him dying would have had a much greater one, I think.
I think it would have been
yeah.
a little bit too unpredictable and uncontrollable if they had decided to go with that route of War Machine dying. You just have to figure War Machine is Iron Man's best friend.
Well,
he's basically like Bucky the Cat, if you were to pin him up.
Tony Stank?
Well, yeah, I guess you could say at that point, like, if that were to happen, there'd be no way he would help Cap anyway.
Yeah.
So, I guess you could...
At least if he's still alive, there is still some decency left inside Stark.
There's still some
as
chance.
If there was any to begin with.
Well, not necessarily decency. There's still a chance for repairs to be made for
to their friendship and to the Avengers.
Yeah. Good point though. So anyway, so back to the fight. Iron Distraction Man. And Stark's trying to kill Bucky. That was like. Tries to incapacitate Cap with the handcuff thing that go to his legs. Okay, whatever, he missed.
Hey, leg cuffs.
Yeah, leg cuffs. It was like, no. So then he's trying to kill Bucky. Cap is trying to, like, get Iron Man to stop. There's multiple scenes where, like, Cap is, like, standing between them and says, look, stop. It wasn't him. It wasn't his fault. Hydra had control of his mind. And Iron Man just basically, like, tosses him aside or something or knocks
and
him over.
And there's also one scene. There's also one... portion of that scene, of this sequence, where Stark has Bucky in a chokehold.
Oh, yeah.
And he's like, do you even remember them? And Bucky goes, I remember all of them. As if he still is haunted by all the misdeeds he's done in the name of Hydra.
Well, I mean, you have to figure, he still would be, because I mean, between the time that they had that conversation in the jet, and they landed, there wouldn't have really been much time for Bucky to like get over his guilt. That is something that is going to take him a while. So he would, but yeah. Overall, the fight scene, I thought it was fantastic. The music was great. The action was great. I liked how they were constantly, the balance of the fight constantly changed. Like one moment, Cap has the upper hand. The next second, Iron Man has the upper hand. Bucky's trying to escape, but then whenever he has to fight, like he has the upper hand, and then Iron Man has the upper hand. I liked how that balance kept changing. So
yeah.
It's not like you can't really go. So like the Cap fans can't say Cap dominated the fight. The Iron Man fans can't say Iron Man dominated the fight.
And
they both get their hits. They both
And then Bucky just jumps in whenever he can, but he's trying to get out.
Yep. And then we get to the bit where Iron Man or Cap is separated from his shield. He falls down one way. Bucky goes the other way. Iron Man goes after Cap and is trying to punch him. Bucky comes in, and then we get that's where the moment that was in the trailer happens, where like Cap and Bucky are switching the like tossing the shield back and forth, trading punches.
And knocking the, and beating the ever-dipping daylight out of Storm.
Whenever I watch the trailer, that scene is like, oh my gosh. And then...
I can imagine Storm's like, ow, 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 ow,
that's
my face.
Yes!
That's my nose.
That's basically what he's doing. He finally manages to get a blast off, throws Cap against the wall. Bucky...
bashes him against the wall with his robot arm and actually tries to rip out the central component.
Pressing his face, like, mashing his face into the wall, jamming his hand into the thing. And you can see it, like, it's starting to crumble. Like, there's literally, like, pieces coming off. Like, I like that. That was
Wait, point. Does, like, Iron Man use his shot and knock Captain back to the wall?
Yes. Like, he used, like, when they're doing the thing where, like, they're switching the shields and
hitting. That kind of confuses me, because I remember the first Avengers movie,
yeah.
What were they called? That invaded?
The Chitauri.
The
yeah.
Chitauri. Like, one shot from his hand would go right through a Chitauri, but when it hits Cap, it just sends him flying.
Thicker armor? Or...
Yeah, the Chitauri were just mostly, like, rotten, disgusting flesh mixed with mechanical, cyborg-like components in a shabby construct of different type of creatures and warriors.
It's like the Russian army. There's a lot of them.
Yeah, exactly.
But they are terrible at their job!
Yeah.
Other than the elites.
So then, Iron Man, he fires the blast out of his chest and tears Bucky's arm off, knocks him down.
And then Cap goes at him after some dialogue.
No, there wasn't. At that point, there wasn't. They were way past dialogue.
No, wasn't there that line where he's like, oh, he's my friend.
A couple seconds later.
Yeah.
So then, like, we get the dramatic Cap runs at Iron Man and then fires the beam, and then we get that classic pose where, like, they've got, like, he's got the shield, Iron Man's firing into the shield. You can very clearly tell they're doing that pose on purpose, and...
Yeah, and then remember,
that
he's
was
like,
cool, though. That was still awesome.
Stark. I don't know.
The next scene is Zemo and the Black Panther.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, that I liked.
That was pretty cool.
What do you think?
I like the Black Panther suit in this. At least it doesn't look like it's like made of some kind of fabric. Because in the cartoons and in the comics, it actually was... It was mainly more of like just like a skin-tight suit.
Yeah.
But it was laced with some vibranium to make it bulletproof and knife-proof and flame-resistant.
Yeah. Yeah, but the main thing of interest in this scene is how, like, Black Panther finally lets go of his anger. Like, he sees Zemo. We see the voice message that Zemo was playing.
Over and over.
In the movie. Like, that's a constant, like...
I actually thought that was a phone call.
Yeah, me too.
And then it's like, oh, wow.
Like,
wow, he lost his family in Sokovia.
Yeah, and he's constantly replaying, like, the last time he heard his wife's voice. And I'm like, oh, dang. And then Black Panther's like... Whoa, like, I see what vengeance has done to you. This is what I'm gonna end up if I keep doing this.
Yeah.
Yes, and then, like, Zemo tries to commit suicide, Black Panther stops him, and I was like...
The living are not done with you.
Yes.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, the living are so not done.
And then he gets a visit from Bilbo Baggins.
Please do something. Please make me mad. Please try to escape. So, like, whatever.
It'll make my job so much more fun.
Yes!
I love the fact that they had that actor because there was, like I told you, there was a whole deleted scenes thing to The Hobbit where Bilbo Baggins is just constantly flipping off the camera and because that's the way Bilbo puts on the ring. And
oh,
it's just funny to think about what if he had done that to Zemo.
Oh my gosh. I still see Sherlock every time I see him. Is like, I don't even know the name of the character he plays in the movie. I know I said this in the first movie, but I don't even know that.
That's...
Don't do that again.
Alright.
Yeah.
Do you still see them? You still see Watson from Sherlock, right?
Yeah, it's like, that's what I see. I'm
well,
sorry.
I haven't seen that, so the way we see, and neither is he, the way we see it is we see Bilbo Baggins, which is even more funny, because he's even shorter. Because, like, okay, the actor's already short as he is. He's only like 5'6". So he's about our height, and compared to average people, that's
actually... like 1 inch taller than he is.
Yeah, and then he's like... And then, as a hobbit, he's supposed to be like only about 4 to 3 feet tall.
Dang. Okay, so...
Anyway, moving on.
So now we're at the dialogue scene with the Iron Man and Cap. Like Cap, or not Cap, Iron Man basically punches, or no, it's Cap is basically punching the ever-loving daylights out of Iron Man. And this is something that Ray told me, was Iron Man's suit has the ability to predict its opponent's moves. Iron Man does that, analyzes Cap's pattern, and then catches the shield.
And that's how Cap actually loses the initiative.
Yeah, he loses the initiative, he gets knocked down, and that's where the dialogue happens, where he says, sorry, Tony, like, he's my friend. And then Iron Man says, so was I. Wah, boom. Like, goes at him.
And then after, like, and then I think Tony, and then I think Cap gets knocked back, and then he gets back, and he's like, he's bleeding from his mouth, and he's like, I did this all day.
Yeah, basically Iron Man grabs him, throws him, and
you know
then
what's
points
weird?
The blast thing at him, and says, yeah,
you know what, I was... When Cap got up and was like breathing heavy and felt the blood, I was like, oh, I know what's coming next.
What?
I can do this all day.
Yeah.
The same line from the alley when we first saw it in the first Avengers movie.
Oh, whoa.
He shoots that moment.
We noticed
that.
That's his signature line.
He's actually, almost every movie Captain America's been in, he's used that line once.
I can do this all day.
Yeah. Yeah, so like, and then Iron Man's about to blast him again. And then Bucky tries to, like, get him, distracts him. Iron Man kicks him in the gut, and then Cap picks him up, slams him in the ground, and then starts, like, punching him, gets his shield, knocks his helmet off, and then jams it, like, right into the center thing.
Yeah, in the Unibeam, the repulsor blaster that makes the Unibeam.
One thing I like, this was actually really cool. Like, he does, like, he slams the thing down, and he's, like, leaning over the shield desperate, and the way his eyes close for a second, I almost thought, like, he's trying not to cry almost. Like, it hurts him to fight his friend, and he's like, he realizes that he almost killed his friend, and he's like, regrets it.
Yeah.
Like, I like to read that in a little bit, just a little, but.
Yeah, it's really, when you know how to read into emotion like that, you can definitely tell, you can definitely pick up on the emotions that people are feeling when you see scenes like that. Because you definitely did draw a comparison. I could think of a similar scene in The Force Awakens with the death of Han Solo.
Yeah.
You can definitely tell the emotion that is there, the lighting, the way it all just plays into his death, and to the death of Ben Solo and the rise of Kylo Ren.
Yeah.
And spoilers to anyone who has not yet seen it, if you have not seen it, get the DVD or just go see it.
If you haven't seen it yet, you're not a Star Wars, I can tell, you just have no interest in Star Wars.
No,
at all.
If he hasn't
seen it. That means you're Star Trek.
No, if he hasn't,
which is
I was about
thing.
To say,
yeah.
If you haven't seen it, then you're a Star Trek fan.
Yeah, Star Trek's okay.
Or die-hard Star Trek.
Who
does not associate with Star Wars.
Star Trek I like. It's just I think I just prefer Star Wars over Star Trek. I mean, Star Trek is good in its own rights.
Yeah.
It has its own good stuff. My grandfather loves the original.
I like DS9, the Mirror Universe, and Voyager. Those are my two favorites.
Yeah, but I just prefer Star Wars. That's just my taste.
Me too. Star Wars has or had thousands of years of lore and history and all, like, the Force and these really cool swords called lightsabers.
Back to Civil War.
The Galactic Civil War?
Star Wars reference.
No! The American Civil War.
Okay, that's Caleb's department. He's the he's the walking history.
By this time, the Confederates had lost.
That's enough.
Okay, yeah. So then Cap pulls himself back up, he goes over to Bucky, they're about to walk out, and then Iron Man yells that Cap doesn't deserve the shield because his father made it. And Cap, would anyone else like to say it?
Drops the shield.
Yeah.
Drop the shield.
And then, you know, what I noticed, it still had the scratch marks from the panda.
Oh yeah. He hasn't had time to fix it yet, because they've been on the run.
Oh, you know, actually, in the comics, there was one point in which the shield got broken for the last time in the comics.
Oh yeah.
And then it got reforged again. That was like the 10th time. And then but there was a flaw in it. It still had a large scratch on it. But Cap said he didn't mind. It actually gave the old girl a little bit of personality.
I know, right?
as if she didn't have personality enough already.
Yeah.
With the way he could throw it.
It's a Frisbee with the Star Spangled Banner on it.
Bye-bye. She's got attitude.
Yep. But yeah, overall that entire scene, I thought it was amazing. The fighting itself was great. The music tied in perfectly. Yeah, that was amazing. What'd y'all think? I've been kind of directing it, so like, just to keep us, try to keep us on topic.
Wait,
like,
you
don't.
Directed that movie?
I've been trying to direct the conversation.
So yeah,
stay on topic for it.
Yeah, okay.
I know I've been failing half the time. You don't need to tell me.
And, yeah, anyway, I liked the scenes, but the next scene is what just took the movie away. The scene with, Stanley.
Hey, I got a package for Tony Stank.
What?
I'm never letting go of that.
One table for Tony Stank.
Yeah, that's
table
for my day.
Table,
you know,
for
I'm
one,
never
Tony
go
Stank.
Yeah.
Table for
the
one.
Scene, the bit right before that, while they're talking about like how War Machine is like, I knew each battle I flew in could be my last, but this battle, like, even being paralyzed, it hasn't weakened my resolve. I still think we need the Accords. I like that bit.
Table for one, LeBron James.
Don't you mean Tony Stank? I mean Stark. Sorry, Tony. I can just see
he's
War Machine.
Rat thing.
I can just see War Machine doing that.
He's never gonna let that go. You know, he said that in the movie.
Please, please, Infinity War, have him say that in front
okay.
of Cap.
Okay, hold
please
on.
Please have him say that in front of Cap.
Hold on a second. Did anyone ever catch Robert Downey Jr. having food on the set again?
No, what did he do?
No, it's in the Avengers, you know, where they're eating the blueberries?
Yeah.
That was not scripted. Robert Downey Jr. actually snuck that onto the set.
Oh my god.
Yeah, he did that. I'm trying to think, did he do that in Age of Ultron? No, I don't think he did.
I don't think he did it in Civil War either. The director was probably like,
we are strict about our food loss.
Oh, still, it added to that. I mean, that was a pretty good scene in the first Avengers movies. I mean, it was like, okay, was that scripted? And then they go back and like, no, that was not scripted. He snuck that onto the set. Leave it to the sarcastic Robert Downey Jr. to sneak food onto the set as Tony Stark.
Yep. Okay, so back to the movie.
Yes.
He puts Ross on hold.
As he said he would.
I love how Ross is like, wait, no, don't you dare. Beep.
I don't like you no more.
Got what you deserved, old
and
man.
Also, I like
from
how.
Talking about the Hulk.
Remember how Captain said to the other guys that were working alongside him, "I'll come back for you." And at the end of the movie, he does.
Oh yeah, I like that. That is actually
he kept his promise.
That is actually one thing that I really like is how. Like one could probably make the complaint that oh well the Civil War happened too quickly, it's over in one movie. This is just the beginning.
I don't think
we're gonna be getting Captain America 4 Civil War Part 2, but I do think like the Sokovia Accords, as far as the United Nations is concerned, are still law. The Avengers have gone rogue.
It was Little Matthew.
Okay, yeah. So like they're not gonna be following that rule, so like they're still gonna be.
And guess where they're hiding out?
Where? Oh, Wakanda, yeah.
Wakanda!
Yep.
Because we see a giant panther.
Yeah, that
and
was...
there's only one nation on Earth in the Marvel Universe that has that.
Yeah, so they're going to be... Oh, yeah, they're hiding out there, yeah. So,
no,
yeah,
I thought
like,
we were in Tennessee.
I kind of think, like, the bit... The Cap and Iron Man's battle, that's over. Iron Man is basically saying, okay, I'm done, I've had it, I'm spent, I'm out for a while.
Like
but
he did at the end of Age of Ultron.
Yeah. So he's taking another one of his breaks to recuperate, think things over. Cap, he has the cell phone that Cap gave him, so if he needs Cap, like, what? I really liked how like Cap actually apologized for that, like,
yeah.
Not telling him that he knew what happened to his parents.
But again, you know, he shouldn't have known, but, you know.
But the fact that, like, the movie writes it so that he did know and didn't tell Iron Man, I mean, I've seen clips on YouTube where, like, and in the comments, like, people criticize Cap and, like, say, like, they hate him now and, like, they don't like his character, and I'm like, well... Okay, yeah, he screwed up, but the thing is, like, at some point you have to write your characters as making mistakes, because the thing is, like...
If they're perfect all the time, then what's the point?
Exactly.
It's not like Superman.
Yeah, exactly.
It gets redundant, and nobody likes it.
Like Goku
yeah.
said,
but, like,
your powers have been boring since the 1940s.
Yeah, but, like, more importantly than that is, like, the writers can't make them perfect, because nobody is perfect, and we cannot create something perfect. But at the same time, you have to have imperfections. You have to have your characters occasionally mess things up.
And that's why Disney's doing better than DC.
Yeah, exactly, because that makes your characters more relatable. It makes them feel like people as opposed to perfect entities.
Yep.
Ethan, that's one thing that I really liked about that scene is like they show like, oh, Cap's actually not perfect. Whereas like the rest, like, he's not the completely perfect centurion of liberty. He is as a human, just like you or me.
Except that he is nearly twice as strong.
Except for that.
Like back in the back in the Civil War, during like the Revolutionary War and on until the Civil War, everyone thought war was such a heroic thing, and people went out there. Or heroes for the country. And then when photography came out and people witnessed what actually happened in the Civil War, it was kind of shocking.
Yeah.
And the problem is that they got out there right as the bodies were starting to decompose. So the reason why, if you look at a Civil War picture and you see the bodies seem to be bigger, like they're puffed up, it's because the gases are building up inside them.
Okay.
They haven't been cleaned up yet.
That's gross.
And the thing is that most of the pictures you see are of Confederate casualties because the Union didn't want... Because the people in the North didn't want to see Union casualties.
Well, okay. It's going to happen on either sides, buddy.
Yeah.
That's true. There was more, if you go to the South, there's a lot more pictures of Union casualties than there are. But you go up North, it's in reverse.
You want to make it look like your side's winning so people aren't like, oh my gosh, we're losing, we suffered this great defeat, we took all these casualties.
Oh no, the South was already, the South, no, they were losing when they lost Tennessee.
Well,
Tennessee was lost very early in the war.
But to reality, if now you just look back at those, now you just see, it's really sad.
Yeah.
Oh,
it's just like watching the Titanic movie and relating that to what really happened.
Oh yeah.
Oh yeah. I mean, when that film came out, whatever few Titanic survivors actually saw that film probably were haunted by old memories and nightmares.
I mean, it's like
saving Private Ryan for D-Day survivors.
Well, that's their fault for watching it, man. That's all I can say to that.
And
you knew it's called Titanic. You knew it would be about it. Why did you watch it?
The Titanic, 1,517 people died. Guess how many survived? 710.
I forgot one time I heard it was 750.
And I don't know, but most of those people died from frostbite.
Yeah.
And hypothermia.
They kept deploying the boats before they were full, and it's like...
No, a lot of people, when the stern actually sat beneath the water, all those people that ended up in the water as they got washed off, they froze to death.
Okay,
anyway,
so,
back on topic.
Yeah, so basically, I think that we basically reached the end of the movie. The only thing left to talk about is the scene where
Bilbo!
We already talked about that, the scene where Bucky goes back into cryostasis until they can take the mind control Hydra put in and out. And Black Panther actually promises to keep Bucky safe if anyone figures out he's there. And I was like, okay, yeah, dang.
Yeah.
But I actually like that bit. Like,
and then remember, like, you know they find us, they're going to come here.
I counted.
No, and then he's like,
I'd like to see them try.
Right. And then it show pans out and we see exactly
yes.
where they are. A giant Black Panther that can only be one place. Wakanda, home of the Panther God.
Yeah. So, okay.
Black Panther.
So that is the entirety of Civil War. I think now, like, predictions on, like, what's going to happen in the next few Marvel movies, like, how it's Civil War ties into all that.
I think, like, the sides, they're starting to settle. Tony's starting to forgive and just forget. And pretty much, I'm pretty sure by, like, Avengers Infinity Wars, that pretty much all of them will be together and they'll take on Thanos.
What I'm hoping...
I'm hoping to see a Thor movie, or at least something to do with the Hulk, at least, because they haven't made a Hulk movie since that
Ragnarok? You're getting that in your wish. They're made Thor and Hulk are teaming up for Ragnarok.
Ragnarok?
Yeah.
Oh, that's Doomsday.
That's
you
Doomsday
know,
for
you
Ragnarok,
know, like,
basically, but Hulk is a big part of that movie.
Oh.
Have you ever seen Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D.?
Bit of it, yeah. I saw that where Hydra takes over, and then to the end of the first season.
Later on in the series, you'll find out about these people called Inhumans, and I heard in, like, 2026, they're making a movie called Inhumans.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, it's about these, basically, okay, look, there's this alien empire, you see them in Guardians of the Galaxy, the Kree. A long time ago, when the Earth was very young, they visited the Earth, and embedded certain strands of their DNA into some of the humans. And now, whenever these humans begin to activate their powers, they basically become, like...
weapons of war.
Weapons of war. Like, some of them could cause earthquakes, some of them could short out entire electrical grids.
Like,
some of them could even make things so combustion to turn into flame bombs.
So yeah, that... the Sokovia Accords are probably going to impact that, too, because one thing... I did see a clip of this on Facebook, because I haven't actually kept up with Agents here, but one thing was Agent Coulson talking to this guy from... I don't remember if he was from the United Nations or the U.S. military, but he basically said, like, the U.S. military guy said, Sokovia Accords are now the law of the land, like, we can make you, like, legit if you register any inhumans you have with you.
Oh, yeah, that...
Coulson basically pretty much turned him down.
Oh, yeah, that actually was in the last episode.
Yeah.
The last episode of season 2, the season 2 finale.
I do kind of like that they do establish that the Sokovia Accords aren't just, oh, well, we get to boss the Avengers around. Like, they did keep that aspect from the comics of, oh, well, register any weirdos with superpowers.
It's meant to try to rein in the superpower people
yeah.
from being to basically from trying to put themselves above the law.
Yeah, it's just that's not the focus of Civil War. The focus of Civil War is can we or can we not tell the Avengers what to do and when can we do that? Yeah, like, that's just the aspect.
I don't think
kind of,
they should.
Yeah.
Like, the Avengers need to be the ones to make the final call because they are the ones with the powers, not the politicians.
One thing.
It's just the way that the UN is structured. I don't agree with the way that they try to play down.
Well, one thing that I did get into a comment, you know, like a comment chain with someone on Facebook that basically he said, like, people are afraid of the Avengers because, like, yes, they have saved the world, but the thing is, like, what happens if, like, you know the phrase, absolute power corrupts, if we're letting the Avengers have all the power and call all the shots, what happens if they turn on us? So I do think the Avengers do need to have some sort of accountability.
But that's
but,
what S.H.I.E.L.D. was for.
Yeah, exactly. But, like, that's, like, the Avengers do need some accountability. They do need, like, something to, like, I don't know, accountability is someone to answer to, but not for the reasons presented in the movie. I do agree that the UN is not in the right on that one.
Yeah, the UN was not the right choice. I think, if anything, they should try to rebuild S.H.I.E.L.D. and try to get S.H.I.E.L.D. back up and running as an accountability system.
Well, they do have
the
it.
Avengers.
They do have it. It's just, I think, like, S.H.I.E.L.D.'s kind of been running under the radar. They're not, like, legitimate and more...
Well, actually,
like,
they're hiding under
yeah.
the protection of the UNSC,
really. The DCA, I think.
Oh,
no. What's it called? It's like a bunch of freaking acronyms.
Someone.
The
TCU?
S.H.I.E.L.D.
Yeah, it's the security. It's a, what the heck does S.H.I.E.L.D. stand for? It's like the Security Homeland...
Intelligence? Security Homeland Intelligence?
Intelligence?
Logistics Division?
Eastern Logistics Division? I don't know, something like that.
What are the heck it stands for?
I
don't know.
It stands for I don't give a frick.
Yep. Okay, so back to predictions. What I am hoping is going to happen is this Black Panther movie is what that if that's going to be a continuation of the Civil War storyline where someone from like General Ross's brigade figures out that Bucky is there and we go through this whole thing where like the Black Panther and like has to like defend like fight to protect Bucky and the Avengers or something like that.
Yeah, in fact, there's even a cartoon called Avengers Earth's Mightiest Heroes. And
oh, yeah.
The Black Panther has, at times, even turned on the Avengers because he needs to protect his homeland. And he even sometimes closes the border, and he literally shows up with his army, and he's like, "No outsider may set foot in Wakanda."
Yeah.
And then he literally gives the battle cry, "Wakandans, defend Wakanda!" And they like pop up in the grass. Like basically, they are like tribal African civilization mixed with modern technology on a grand scale that has not been seen.
It would be interesting to see him face off against General, instead of the Avengers, see him face off against General Ross with that kind of thing.
General Ross, you mean the...
The general
yeah.
that has the...
Like, he's coming for Bucky.
Yeah, but I think, hopefully, if they do, like,
yeah.
there's this villain I know of that the Black Panther had a bit of a beef with. In the comics, he killed T'Chaka, the king of Wakanda, that was the father of T'Challa, who is the Black Panther who joins the Avengers.
Yeah.
His name is Claw. He has a mechanical hand because the Black Panther cut it off.
It could be something like, for the movie version, because the movies are going with a different storyline.
Yes.
It could be something like Claw tried to make a bid for the throne and the Black Panther stopped him.
That was true,
and
because in Wakandan culture, actually, there was a moment in which, in Wakandan culture, in the comics, there was this thing where the king could be challenged if he was not strong enough, and a stronger one was chosen to lead.
So, after a quick break, we are back. My sister is in the room with us now. Okay, alright.
Hello!
So,
hello.
Alright, shoot. Alright, so back to prediction. So I think if they do that for the Black Panther thing, the Civil War storyline is just going to get like even more heated and more tense, and then Infinity War is what's going to resolve the Civil War storyline. Like, that's going to be the thing where it's like,
actually,
Thanos shows up and it's like, oh,
Cap,
like, we have to team up.
Avengers
again.
Infinity Wars is going to be a two-part thing.
I know, but what I'm saying is, like, that's what's going to could resolve the Civil War storyline, because it's like, okay, Thanos has the Infinity Stones, he's doing all this, we have to team up in order to stop him, like, this infighting has to stop. Like, kind of dynamic. It could work.
Like, allies against a common foe, even though we still have a little bit of a beef.
Yeah. Like, we have to. Yeah, but like, yeah, that's kind of the route I think they could go with the Civil War storyline. Because, like I said, last time I was at your house, like, this is very much the Lexington and Concord of the Civil War. Like, this is the beginning. They haven't resolved the conflict by the end of the movie. Cap and Iron Man have sort of kind of resolved their thing, but the overall issue is still there.
You know, one character we grazed over.
What?
Spider-Man.
Do we?
Yeah, we kind of grazed over Spider-Man.
Well, that's because he kind of...
Well, we talked about him a lot in part one, but he's, after the airport battle, he is not present, so we haven't talked about him in this one.
I know, but I felt like we grazed over him earlier, but it's kind of like, I feel like he's going to play a larger role when it goes on. Like, Infinity Wars is when all of them get together.
Yeah, I heard there's like a whole total of like 67 characters.
Counting the Guardians of the Galaxy, that's gonna be awesome.
So that's all the Avengers.
I can't wait till like Hawkeye gets a taste of like of Rocket, because there was a cartoon, Avengers vs. Mighty Heroes, when the original Guardians of the Galaxy from the comics met the Avengers, Hawkeye was like, okay, so are we gonna shoot? Because there's a tree and a raccoon giving me a dirty look over here.
Actually, no, the original Guardians of the Galaxy from the comics did not look like the ones from the movie.
So it's a bear and a squirrel?
No. There is no Rocket, there is no Groot. It's totally different. I think they redid it for the movie. Some things are the same, but they're not exactly.
Actually,
no. Tiger and a
kitten? I don't even think there's a kitten. There's a guy who looks like, the Silver Surfer.
Anyway, moving on.
So, that's my prediction. Have we all done our predictions for what?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, one thing, jumping off the Spider-Man thing, I think Cap is like kind of going to be like sort of a mentor thing over Spider-Man. Because you can just tell during that fight, like, he kind of takes a shine to Spider-Man. Like, you can tell, like, he likes the kid. He takes him down because he has to, but he likes this kid. And if they ever teamed up, Cap would be like,
mentor to him.
Yeah,
and then of course Ant-Man.
And actually, Spider-Man did have his bright moments, like when he figured out how to take down Ant-Man.
That was awesome.
No, Ant-Man was in his giant man form.
Yeah.
Star Wars reference.
yeah,
okay, that was hilarious. At the fact that they actually brought in the giant man portion of Ant-Man's character. The fact that he could grow to 60 feet tall.
Is anyone on our side hiding any fantastic or shocking abilities they'd like to disclose? I'm open to suggestions. Okay, so I think you basically covered everything. So general ratings, thoughts overall on the movie. You first.
16 out of 10.5.
Okay.
It was through the roof. Okay, in terms of my ratings, I have to give it a solid like 9.5 out of 10.
Yeah.
Because it is like, it is a good movie. There were some things that left it that dropped it down out of the top spot. But they were very few.
What? That kiss saying, would you want
to
play
that? That, yeah, like, okay, like, actually, we needed a little bit more to that, relationship that was there.
Hey, still a better love story than Twilight.
Heck yes! Heck yeah, I mean,
yes.
Dirt is a better love story than Twilight.
What?
Dirt.
It's just the stuff.
They're always
kissing.
Yeah. Okay, so
it's a joke.
This is kind of where I'm going to be making a lot of comparisons to The Force Awakens. Like, The Force Awakens I rate as a 7 out of 10. The way I do it is I divide it up into two things. Visuals, which
speaking
is
of
5.
Speaking of which, real quick, after we're done, I have something to talk to you about that.
Okay, so like how I rate things is I divide it into two parts, each getting 5 things. The visual, special effects and everything, Force Awakens gets a 5 out of 5 for. Story-wise, and that includes like acting, characters, the general, the sequence of events, everything that happens in the film, that's where it gets a 2 out of 5. So it's a 7 out of 5, or 7 out of 10 movie that I don't give a crap about. Like, the action scenes, I'm entertained, but, and like, it's not boring, but I'm not invested. I can't care about what's happening. With Civil War, visually, I give it a 5 out of 5. It had some moments that were visually phenomenal, like the animations were good, the moment where like the Avengers first all clash and you've got like Cap fighting Iron Man, Bucky versus Black Panther, Scarlet Witch casting magic, Spider-Man hopping all over the place,
Giant Man coming into play.
Yeah,
no, that was
you
later.
Know what?
Yeah,
you know
but
what?
Like that was like it took my breath away. I'm looking
Scarlet
at this
Witch.
Wide eyed. Hold on, I'm looking at it wide eyed, going, "Oh crap! Like this is happening. I am seeing this." And then story wise. Yeah, I do agree. Like, there are slight moments that do kind of drop it down that don't make sense, that are kind of like, what? But they don't, overall, like, they are very few and far between. They don't affect my enjoyment of the movie at all. I am, like, in the theater, I'm like, I'm invested. I was on the edge of my seat. Every time they were talking, I was like, oh my god, like, okay, keep going. Like, where is this going to end? What is going on? Where is this going to end? Where is this going to lead to? As opposed to, I don't give a crap. Yeah, so I would give it a solid like 9.5 out of 10 for me too.
And
like it blew me away.
Probably. Usually when there's a plot twist in a movie, for some reason I can usually figure out when there's going to be. But in this one, I thought they were going to have to face those 5 super soldiers.
I seriously thought that too.
Yeah,
it would have been epic.
But that's seriously just like, what the frick?
I was like, wait. He wasn't planning to unleash them.
He just shot them and lured them there in order to make Cap and Iron Man go at each other.
Did you really think I wanted more of you? Well.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, yeah.
The thing about Scarlet Witch, she could have abused her powers and just killed everyone. Because she has the ability to do that.
I mean, we
but
see
she
that
chose
when,
she's, not
when
to.
She definitely feels her brother die in the Age of Ultron movie, when she feels Quicksilver die in the Age of Ultron film, she unleashes her powers into just a fit of sorrow that obliterates everything around that stupid switch.
Yeah, basically, yeah.
Yeah.
Yes. Yes, it was, yeah. But yeah, that was a moment where... Okay.
Bring it in!
What are you doing?
Yeah, let's wrap this thing up.
Alright, cool. So this is Phantom Studios signing off.
Sayonara!